Beacon Press Audio presents The Trials of Nina McCall, Sex, Surveillance, and the Decades-Long Government Plan to Imprison Promiscuous Women by Scott Wasserman Stern. This audiobook is narrated by Erin Bennett. Published by Beacon Press Audio, 2018. Author's note. This is a true story. Every character really existed, and every event really happened. All the dialogue can be found in original sources: letters, transcripts, newspaper articles, diaries, archival records, and so forth. I have preserved all original grammatical usages. As I was writing this book, I struggled over a number of decisions regarding terminology, and I will explain three of these here. First, Nina. In the original draft of this book, I referred to its protagonist, Nina McCall, as McCall. I chose to do this because I wanted to be respectful to her, and it struck me as the most respectful possible convention. However, this choice forced me to refer to her mother, Minnie McCall, as Minnie, which to some degree defeated the purpose. Later in the book, Nina got married, then remarried, her last name changing both times, which further complicated matters. Finally, I felt that calling her by her first name would create a sense of intimacy between her and the reader. For these reasons, I have chosen to refer to Nina and her family members by their first names. Second, I originally used the term venereal disease, and VD for short, rather than sexually transmitted infection, and STI. I initially chose to do this because pretty much all of the characters in this book use the phrase venereal disease, which was the convention until relatively recently. However, I came to feel that sexually transmitted infection was not only more medically accurate, but also less stigmatized. I have, however, retained venereal disease whenever quoting someone who said it or wrote it. Third and finally, I labored over how to refer to people who sell sex. In many recent works, authors have chosen to use the term sex worker rather than the more familiar prostitute. After much thought, I chose to use prostitute in this book for a couple of reasons. Sex worker is a broader term. It also encompasses escorts, strippers, exotic dancers, adult film actors, phone sex operators, and others. While prostitute is more specific and indisputably better known. In addition, many of the former prostitutes and sex workers' rights advocates with whom I spoke throughout the course of my research want to reclaim the word prostitute. One told me she preferred the word whore. Most told me they cared far less about the words I used and far more about the story I told. I hope this story is worth it. Introduction. Young lady, do you mean to call me a liar? Nina McCall's decision to go to the detention hospital, the government would later claim, was entirely voluntary. She had, after all, been given a choice in the matter. And though the choice mortified her, though she did not fully understand its ramifications, though she was barely 18 years old, and though, when she tried to take back her decision, she was told it was too late, her signature at the bottom of a 3-paragraph-long voluntary commitment order was all the Michigan authorities needed to claim that she had imprisoned herself in the Bay City Detention Hospital of her own free will. It was Thursday, October 31st, 1918. The weather in the small town of St. Louis, Michigan, was fair, with just a hint of wind coming from Lake Michigan to the west. Winter had not yet truly arrived in central Michigan, notorious for its biting cold, though light flurries were forecasted for the next evening. St. Louis residents were still able to bask in the last flickering vestiges of autumn before yet another hard winter. Nina McCall was, to use the old cliché, just minding her own business. That morning, she had been walking around St. Louis's business district, which consisted of just a few blocks of stores, mere minutes from the home Nina shared with her brother and mother. The business district sat on flat, dusty land, bounded to the north and west by the meandering Pine River. To the east was the Grand Park Hotel, and to the south was Washington Street, the road up which Nina had probably walked to get into town that day. Handsome brick and clapboard buildings with hand-painted gable signs loomed over passers-by, exuding that friendly small-town charm. Little drugstores and garages peppered streets with names like West Saginaw, North Pine, North Mill, and West Center Avenue. Nina entered the St. Louis post office at about 10 o'clock a.m. As she was exiting the post office, Nina locked eyes with Louis N. Martin, St. Louis's deputy sheriff. Martin, a Republican and the owner of a livery stable in his early 40s, was not wholly unfamiliar to Nina. She had met him several times over the past 5 years. Indeed, she had even been inside his West Saginaw Street home when she chummed with Martin's teenage daughter, Bernice. But the sight of the deputy sheriff surely made Nina uneasy. Over the past few days, Nina had seen Martin talking to 4 or 5 girls on the streets of St. Louis. They were girls Nina did not recognize. Martin, ever businesslike, never one to casually converse with women around town, was suddenly chatting with girls left and right. One day he was talking with 2 girls together at a familiar street corner. The next it was 1 girl on her own. He had talked to some right outside the post office Nina had just exited. The girls, Nina recalled, acted so funny. Then some of them got into Martin's car with him, and they drove away. It was all so strange. And now Martin was approaching her. The 2 exchanged words, and Martin told Nina that she would have to report to the office of Health Officer Thomas Carney for an examination. It is unclear whether he told her that Carney, and possibly other government officials, believed Nina had a sexually transmitted infection, syphilis or gonorrhea. Carney would have to examine Nina to verify whether or not she was a carrier of these dreaded, stigmatized conditions, and he would have to do it immediately. Nina abandoned whatever she had been planning to do around St. Louis's business district and walked home. For the past week, home had been above a garage on West Washington Street, owned by a young St. Louis businessman. Ever since Nina's father, Abe, had died in 1916, the family had been moving around rural Gratiot County quite a bit. They had returned to St. Louis, where Nina had attended school on and off as a girl, so that Nina's mother, Minnie, could care for her own ailing father, John. For Minnie, October 31st had started just like any other day. She had eaten breakfast and done some chores around the house, washing the clothing, changing the bed linen, and that sort of thing. Then she heard her daughter coming up the stairs. She could hear that Nina was crying. Minnie asked her daughter what had happened. The sobbing Nina told her mother that she had been ordered to go with Martin to Dr. Carney's office. The 2 talked it over, and Minnie decided to accompany Nina to the examination. Nina and her mother walked a couple blocks away from their house, past the greenhouse, down the road toward Alma, which lay a mere 3 miles away. Along the road, at about 10:30 a.m., they met Martin, who drove the 2 women the rest of the way to the office of Dr. Thomas J. Carney. Carney, a physician in his late 40s, originally from New York, was serving as Alma's beleaguered health officer, devoting much of his time and energy to instituting some of the harshest and least popular methods to combat the influenza epidemic in all of Michigan. Martin pulled up in front of his office and told the McCalls to wait in the car. He went up and, about 5 minutes later, came back to fetch mother and daughter. The first person Nina saw upon entering Carney's office was Miss Howell, the office girl. Then Dr. Carney himself breezed past Nina and Minnie without saying a word. It was the first time either of them had ever seen him. For the next hour or so, the two women sat in the waiting room. Minnie later remembered that they both cried the entire time. Finally, at about 11:30 a.m., Carney returned, and Nina and Minnie followed him into his office. Carney told them that Nina had been reported to him, that somebody had complained. Carney said she would have to submit to a medical examination. Nina asked what the examination was for, and Carney replied that it was for venereal disease. Both mother and daughter objected vociferously. "I knew I wasn't diseased," Nina recalled years later. "I didn't want her to have it, of course," Minnie added, "and I objected to it. I said so." Nina said she would not submit. Carney said she would, and back and forth it went. Finally, he told her it was the law. He was the health officer. He had this authority. Either Nina would submit or she would be sent to the House of Correction, the dismal iron-barred prison in Detroit. Or, Carney added, in Nina's words, "I would be forced to submit to an examination." Finally, Nina agreed. Minnie and a nurse, Miss Olson, accompanied Nina into an examination room. Olson laid Nina on a standard operating table and put a sheet over her. Then Carney came in. Prone as she was, Nina couldn't see the doctor, and he did not tell her what he was about to do. The 18-year-old had never before had a gynecological examination. The deafening silence of the examination room was only broken by the sounds of sobbing coming from Nina and her mother. Carney inserted a speculum into Nina's vagina and probed with both the instrument and, most likely, his fingers. Nina was, she later recalled, "just scared to death all the time. I was afraid." The examination took about 5 minutes. Carney took slides of something Minnie could not see and then left the room with these. Nina and Minnie walked back to the waiting area. For a few minutes, mother and daughter waited for the doctor to come back. Nina began experiencing pain in her groin. Just moments later, Nina estimated less than 3 minutes, Minnie just a few, Carney returned. With an affected phrasing befitting his officialdom, Carney announced, "I find this girl slightly diseased." Nina had been infected with gonorrhea, Carney claimed, for about 2 years, since she was 16 years old. Again, Nina and her mother objected. Nina stated it just could not possibly be true. Minnie started with more restraint. "You don't mean to tell me she has a bad disorder?" she asked. Carney replied, "I didn't say so. I said she was slightly diseased." Minnie told the health officer that she did her daughter's washings and had found no evidence of a sexually transmitted infection. Carney repeated his line about Nina being slightly diseased. Nina insisted she had never been with a man. Carney said he wasn't accusing her of having been with a man, just of being slightly diseased. If Minnie's recollection is to be believed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.